sci-fi segment. Welcome to the sci-fi show on Game Show. And now, it's time for our weekly sci-fi segment. Sci-fi segment. Welcome to the sci-fi show on Game Shout.
Hey, and welcome back to Game Shout Radio. It's time for Sci-Fi Tuesday with Zorth and Jadri.
Hello.
Yay!
Let's all get excited. Well, you know, last week we had a big show with our main scientific topic being what was in your gut. I hope everyone enjoyed that. Yeah, well, hopefully.
Now we know what was in my gut.
But today's episode is all about what's in your brain and what's going on inside your noggin. You know, for those of us that actually put it to good use. You know?
Oh, that was a dig.
Oh. Anyway, you know, let's open this right up with some ancient history. We're going to jump into the evolution of the human brain, and then we're going to go into some more modern discussion about what's happening in our brain today. But our first... Well, as we know, evolution hasn't struck with all of us quite yet. But in two papers published by Dr. Lawn in the Journal of Science, Dr. Lawn and his colleagues have identified specific gene mutations that have swept across the globe too quickly to have been just random alterations in the brain. Prevalence rates is higher than 70% in Europe, for example. So the researchers are arguing that these evolutionary changes which sprung up at the same time as humans evolved, culture and language can't just be coincidental. The two genes involved are over here, microcephalin, which appears to have evolved significantly around 37,000 years ago, around the same time that humans settled in Europe and began producing art. And the second gene, called ASPM, which mutated significantly around 5,800 years ago, coinciding with the rise of cities and the first record of written language. So what do you guys make of that?
Well, not much yet, except that doesn't that tell us that basically there have been, like... in other words, what they're trying to do is justify a change in genetic makeup at the same time that certain events happen? Is this what we're...
Precisely. And that's what's so interesting, because
so
a lot
I'm not
of people
missing
have...
the mark completely.
Yeah, you're right
I'm
on target.
I'm a little lost, you know? Okay.
All right, well, let's see if I can clarify a bit. Now, for the longest time, people have been thinking that humans have generally evolved... you know, into the form that we are in around 200,000 years ago, when our brain capacity effectively reached the size it's at today. So when we look at skeletons...
Some would think, but if that's the case, then we want to have the spaghetti monster theory added to that theory.
Sorry, I'm lost on the spaghetti monster thing.
Well, the spaghetti monster, there's three theories of how we got to be where we are. One is that creationism, the theory of creationism. The second theory is the theory of evolution, as you're discussing that theory. The third theory is the theory of the spaghetti monster. And Trick, maybe you can shed a little bit of light on the spaghetti monster theory.
I figured I could shed a little light.
You're even better at that.
Of course.
Welcome home.
See, the spaghetti monster is actually this giant creature with two meatballs and a string of spaghetti that long, long ago created the entire world. And, see, now, it created the entire world, but didn't want to be seen. Why is that? Well, see, every time somebody tries to carbon date something, our world is actually, I think it was like 2,000 years old, according to the spaghetti monster, and people go and try to carbon date stuff, and it's never true, because the spaghetti monster comes in and changes it, because he's invisible, like a ninja. That's all about the spaghetti monster.
But that would just be another creationism myth. That would just be two different creationism theories. Essentially, we're still limited to two, either evolution or creationism.
Oh, no, no, no.
It's a spaghetti monster.
It's a spaghetti monster creationism versus an omnipotent being. Spaghetti monster is not
creationism.
No, 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 no. Because it doesn't create it. He kind of transmogrifies it into what it is now.
Right.
But okay. You're the scientist. I'm not. Go ahead.
If you want to get technical, evolutionism actually technically had to have started at creationism because something had to have created that, you know, that trigger. So, ha.
Oh, I like that. That's a good point. I didn't even think about that.
Well, what I like about this is, sorry, Solarv, what I like is that we're talking about evolution of different genes in the human brain, which doesn't really say where we came from. It's talking about the actual process of our bodies changing over time to adapt to our new environments. And I think that's what we're talking about.
Yeah, that's a big difference you gotta make between evolution and creationism. Creationism says what happens between point zero and the beginning of life. Evolution tells you what happens from an older form of life to a more modern form of life. Evolution isn't there to tell you, you know, we just appeared from bacteria and became humans. Evolution is there to say the process by which you can go from, say, one type of creature like an ape and then end up with another type of creature like a human. I think that's
So you're not denying the fact that there had to have been at one point a creationism aspect to the whole evolution theory?
Well, no, that's another big mistake that a lot of people make when they hit science. In science, when you get to a point where you don't have an answer, like with the theory of evolution, we don't have an answer for how did you get from point zero to the earliest form of life. We don't immediately say, well, because we don't have an answer now, that means that we can't have an answer at all, therefore it has to be this intelligent design answer. That's not the way science works. Science just says, we acknowledge that we don't have an answer, so we leave this point blank until someone comes along with a really good theory. And when they have a theory, then it's scientifically tested in laboratories to see if it is a viable theory. So when people come up with the theory of like intelligent design, we say, all right, here's a Petri dish, show us intelligent design in action. And to date, no one has ever been able to take a Petri dish and then put a life form in it. Therefore, intelligent design is not a scientific theory.
Because they're not God.
Right, and God hasn't ever done it in a laboratory environment. That's why it's not, can't be used as a scientific theory. I mean,
everything's a little too damn organized to be chaotic and evolutionary. See, but about the people who think that there's a, you know, everything was created and then God's like, hey, play, and then things have evolved, huh?
Right. Well, science doesn't deny that's a possibility.
Well, and science doesn't deny the agency that we've been given either. And
right.
That agency allows us to make our own mistakes, our own decisions. Now, but as far as the mind actually evolving and changing, that, I mean, it has been said that the human does not use but what, a small percentage of our full... Yeah, our full mental capabilities. That's what I keep wanting to say, is like 10%, isn't that it? Or is it 20%?
Yeah, exactly. Now, see, when scientists are looking at these evolving genes, they've noticed that although the brain structure has changed noticeably, the brain size hasn't significantly changed. In other words, we've sort of evolved to this certain brain mass, I think, and I'm just picking a number off the top of my head, I could be wrong, it's about 1,500 cubic centimeters. And that's about the size of the human brain, the volume of it. And the size hasn't changed, but the density of the neurons and the connection, the axons that connect the neurons, has increased and has altered itself, therefore making us sort of smarter. In other words, we've got this much goop, we're just using it more efficiently now.
I'd like to point out that, you know, I have a counterpoint to your evolutionary brain theory. With all the, but basically what you're saying is that the brain has pretty much expanded over the years, giving us the capacity for higher planes of thought than our previous ancestors, correct?
But however, I hear it coming. I know it's coming.
I know. Basically, that's what you're saying, right? You know, basically our brain's bigger, we're smarter.
Well,
Not using as much of it.
It's evolved.
It's evolved, yeah.
It's just, and what he said was it changed at certain specific periods in history, and that appears that the change in the brain caused the changes in those miraculous happenings during that period, like art or like the creation of towns and cities, mm-hmm. and villages and such. But what okay. if it was actually those creations that actually enlarged the brain?
Okay, see, now here's my thing, you know. We have more goop. We use a good 10% of our brain. How do you explain all the dumbasses in the world?
There are a lot of those too, aren't there?
Yeah. Well, actually, I do have something about dumbasses coming up in the next little bit. Let me just finish this one off.
Okay.
The interesting thing.
Sorry.
Until we had genetic testing, right? We were only looking at skeletons of ancient humans. We said from skeletons, the only change we could see in brains was a radical mutation in brain size around 200,000 years ago. But now that we have gene testing, we've noticed that genes, individual genes that control how the brain is formed, have changed at these specific time periods. So the consequence of this study is that we can take DNA samples from people and look at these two genes in individual people and look at how these genes have mutated and actually make tests. You can now test babies for these particular genes and for these particular mutations and make an estimated guess as to whether these babies are potentially smarter than others. That is the interesting implication.
So we can cull the dumbasses before they grow up.
Exactly.
That's right.
Sweet!
It's a brave new world.
No,
1984. Aboard. Aboard.
Well, there are some very scary repercussions. Even when they were doing this test, they took samples from all around the world to try to determine if they could find patterns of these genes migrating from different ethnic groups to other ethnic groups. And they found that while 70% of the people in Europe or more showed signs of, especially the ASPM gene, only 10% of the people tested in West and Sub-Saharan Africa showed signs of these evolved genes. And the scientists are fearing that this may prove as a reason for a justification for prejudices against these groups, which of course the scientists don't want, but you know, there's some people in the world that'll take any ammunition they can get.
Look, the only prejudice we have are against dumbasses. That's what we need to do to them.
Then again, it might
need some bleaching.
Yeah. So that's sort of the evolution of the brain with the genes. But more recently, with a lot of these brain scans, they're noticing a lot of changes in brain composition. And I think that the two interesting things I was going to mention was sort of the teenager phenomenon and the phenomenon of lying. I don't know if any of you guys are familiar with lying, you know.
Nope, not at all.
Yes.
No, I've never lied.
Maybe you've
in my
never
life.
Experienced?
There is a physiological reaction. There is a body, the body actually reacts, whether you want it to or not, to lies. Which is why what a truth, the lie detector does, a polygraph machine, reads these changes in your body when you lie.
Right, yeah, there's actually been a lot
of... You know, jump around that, you know, get pretty wasted or stoned beforehand.
Yeah, that shows up too easily.
Yeah.
Plus, you know, they can just sit you in a cell until you sober up.
Yeah, really, as if.
Fair enough.
Josh, do you have a lot of experience in that?
Perhaps. There was one time in Guam.
You know, there are a lot of different sort of polygraph technologies. There's the classic polygraph where they took your blood pressure and your heart rate and your respiration rate. And there's some more modern technologies where they actually look at the blood flow to the retina in the back of your eye. And apparently that blood flow increases when you're telling a lie. But ultimately it comes down to the following, in that when you're trying to tell a lie, you know, a really serious, complicated lie, it involves a lot of manipulation, thinking ahead, and multitasking. Now I can think of some other things that involve thinking ahead, you know, manipulation and multitasking, like playing a really good, really difficult video game.
Or drying your hair and brushing your teeth at the same time. That's tough.
Yeah, or managing a multinational company.
Or patting your head and rubbing your belly.
That too. But you're always doing that. He practices it all the time. It's really funny.
Yeah, it's pretty hard. I mean, can you do it, Mav?
Oh, we better not let him try, or else he's going to knock over his mic again.
I'm doing it right now. Can't you tell?
I can do it. Oh no, we're losing him. All right. So, lying here, it involves some difficult tasks. A recent study was looking at pathological liars. Again, doing brain scans, looking at the brain composition of people who lie a lot. You know, they make careers out of lying, like con artists that just go from people to people and fabricate lies, and that's what they do for a living. And people like this have 26% more white matter in their brain and 14% less gray matter. So it's like the ratios of matter in their brain have significantly altered compared to the you know, standard normal people.
That is weird. Now, I've seen the human brain, and, well, it is usually fairly gray. Except in...
Right, well, the white matter is composed of axons, or nerve fibers, that connect the nerve cells to each other. So if you have a lot of white matter in your brain, you're better at doing complex processes, like in lying or in manipulation, where you have to take a lot of information and juggle it and calculate it all at the same time. On the other hand, gray matter comprises mostly the cell bodies of the neurons, and they process information. So the more people who have less gray matter tend to break more rules or care less about moral transgressions. So by looking at the
you mean like be liberal.
or be liars. You know, that's the topic we're sticking with here. I guess it could be considered one and the same.
Yeah, true. Generally, or a politician.
I'm just gonna generalize it there.
I think that's a pretty good generalization myself.
We're gonna leave it at that. Anyways, moving on. Gray matter.
Yeah. So gray matter is like, they're both processing different things. Of course, the white matter is more immediate calculation processing, immediate results.
RAM.
Gray matter is more. Yeah, it's kind of like. Well, the white matter is like your CPU. It's actually crunching the numbers. And your gray matter is like your RAM. It's storing and looking ahead, looking at consequences of actions, looking at how people might not like you if you bite off their nose or something like that.
Yes.
Yes. So what the interesting result of this study is that...
You missed the news story, Josh. You missed the news story.
Oh, that's right.
You were out of the newsroom at the time, and I had the news story about the Cambodian couple who bit off the thumbnails and the nose of their daughter. So they
really glad that. I missed that then.
Yeah, you are. Yeah. So
you can always catch the podcast.
That's gray matter. Actually, I think they were on glue at the time.
I know what that's like.
Yeah. Well, I guess you have first-hand experience with it.
Yeah.
Didn't we, like, ban glue from your office here at the studio?
Yep, just the Elmers. No airplane glue. No, you can have the Elmers. It's the airplane glue you can't have anymore.
Oh, that's right. My bad.
We'll use the citrus-smelling stuff.
So, you know, back from glue to what's gluing the brain together. Again, this is, you know, similar to our first story. If we could analyze the composition of brains of people, could we actually use these ratios of white and gray matter to determine which people are more likely to be felons or liars and actually profile people based on their brain composition or, again, based on brain gene mutations? Are we entering a new era of science where we determine people's roles by how their brains are constructed?
Very interesting idea.
That's sort of what I'd like to encourage in further discussion. Actually, we're going to keep going with this very similar topic of fate, destiny, and biological makeup in our science fiction portion. And we're going to be looking at some anime and some other stuff. And our science fiction portion is coming up right after this.
Millions of people love Newegg.com. Go on that website and check it out. You'll see what I'm talking about. There's a whole testimonial page. People are using the L word when it comes to Newegg.com. They say love. I love Newegg.com. How is Newegg.com earning this kind of devotion? Well, they sell computers, components, and electronics. That's true. But it's the great price. It's the huge selection. It's the fair shipping. And it's because the customer service is so great. They actually care about your satisfaction. They have video cards, routers, wireless networking equipment, DVD players, hard drives, software, digital cameras, and unbelievable fair shipping. So, I can't sing the praises of Newegg.com enough, and neither can anyone else. So whether you need a motherboard or the mother of all TVs, go to Newegg.com. You'll see what their millions of happy customers are raving about. Once you know, Newegg.com.
Are you looking for a stable game server hosting company? Well, BFG Servers has been in business since 2001. Looking for a game server hosting company with real credibility? Well, BFG Servers is a premier provider of internet gaming, voice, and web hosting services. Are you looking for a responsive, knowledgeable technical support? Well, BFG Servers generally responds to account holder technical issues within 1 hour. BFGservers.com, when size does matter.
And welcome back to Game Shout Radio. It's time for the sci-fi portion of Sci-Fi Tuesday. Oh yeah.
Yay!
Woo! So we've just spent the first half of our science portion discussing the evolution of the human brain and how people might be predetermined to be smarter or liars or criminals based on the genes they have or the amount of different brain matter that they have. Well, you know, this sort of complex ethical question has been dealt with not just in the realm of science, but also in the realm of science fiction. And actually, one particular series that dealt with this has just come to an end. The Gundam Seed Destiny, the sequel to Gundam Seed, has ended last week. The final 50th episode is out. So I'm going to pay a little tribute to this particularly good series. Cue it in, Mav. TM Revolution comes again with another great song. Gundam Seed Destiny, it's the sequel to Gundam Seed. Gundam Seed was picked up, it is licensed in North America. It's actually airing on several TV channels. I'm pretty sure you can get it in whatever area you're in, either on like a Cartoon Network or a children's network. But, you know, this is one of the things that always frustrates me, because even though it's Gundam and it's, you know, a cartoon and there's big mechs blowing each other up, these things aren't really aimed at children, there is actually a very deep philosophical question being asked. And the question in Gundam Seed Destiny is whether it would be better for the human race to have everyone's role predetermined by their genes, i.e., you know, this person is genetically created to be an awesome basketball player, therefore this person will never have confusion in life about what they're actually going to do, or if it's better to leave people the way they are and let them pick out their own destiny. So of course there's the whole destiny cue, and this really mixes in with the science portion we were talking about. We're talking about whether people could be smarter based on their genes, whether people could be better liars based on their brain makeup. Well, that's a question that this anime series attempts to ask. So it's definitely an awesome series. I encourage you to pick it up. I'm sure it's going to be brought out on DVDs in North America soon. If you can't wait, there is now batch torrents available to download all 50 episodes, so I wouldn't directly encourage people to do that. It's better if you're certain you're going to pick up the series when it comes out on DVD, then by all means download the torrents and watch it, and then go out and buy the DVDs, because it's something you're going to have to put in your collection anyway, especially for all of us Gundam fans. Now, Seed is not a rip-off of the Gundam series. It is made by Bandai, the people that own the Gundam license. It's just not part of the Universal Century like the rest of Gundam. So, Jattery, do you have any cool news bits?
Well, I know you're mentioning Gundam Seed, just they stop at 50 episodes. Well, there's right. Another anime series that I've been watching for a really long time now, and that's Bleach. This is done by the same guys that did Naruto, which I think we previewed a while back when it was on Cartoon Network.
Yeah, Bleach is a very fun series. I've been watching that one too. I think they've recently done a double episode. They're up to 52-53.
Mm-hmm. And what a good episode that was. Well, hopefully that series comes to America as well. I would love to see it come on Cartoon Network or whatever else. It was excellent, excellent series. And I don't know how long it's going to run. It's still running, so...
Yeah, these series just keep on going. I kind of felt that Destiny was coming to an end because Seed went exactly 50 episodes, so when episode 49 of Destiny was coming out, I was like, oh, it's going to come to an end, and I really want to see more of this, but I guess they just cap it at a nice round number each time for these two.
Well, you never know. You might see another Gundam Seed series coming about, like after Destiny, another series. You know.
That is true, because Destiny did pick up right where Seed left off. It's the first time we've ever had like a really solid sequel in the Gundam universe. I mean, most of these series like Wing, X, they just sort of had their separate alternate universes, and they didn't bring apart true sequels the way Destiny grew out of Seed.
Well, we've got a really odd story, it looks like, from Todd Hollinshead, the CEO of ID Software. Apparently, he's looking to make a Quake movie now, no matter how good or bad the Doom movie goes.
Yeah, he certainly is, but that's all the time we have for this science fiction show. We encourage everyone to join us on our forums for further discussion, and you're listening to Game Shout Radio.
This is Game Shout Radio, the number one talk game station in the world. Visit GameShout.com for more info. Game Shout. Game Shout.